Thank you. morning and welcome. Thank you for joining us on this beautiful Sunday morning. It is a Resurrection Sunday, friends. It is the epic of Christianity. It is the reason why we live, why we exist, and the reason why we can say we are the body of Christ. In the tradition that I grew up, we often say on a day like day, the pastor or whoever is leading the service will say, Christ is risen. And the response often is, he is risen indeed. So I'm going to do it. Imagine you're standing before me and I want a response from you. Friends, Christ is risen. Amen. And I will want you to even write your response either on Discord or on the YouTube channel. And by the way, talking about Discord, there's actually a couple of our folks that go to themeetinghouse.com/discord during the service. We interact. And one thing I want you to do today in our Easter celebration is, what is your Easter story? Well, what is that Easter story that you have learned or have gained from your own tradition? We'll love to hear from you. You can type your story on the YouTube channel, or you can share a link of your story of what really impacts you on Easter Sunday, and so that we can be able to participate in that conversation. You can do it as well on the Discord server. Our friends, it is always great to hear each other's story, because the story of Easter is that story of invitation that welcomes us in. And so thank you once again for joining us on the subject of giving. You know, the church demonstrate to us by Christ going on the cross of Calvary, by first giving his life to us and inviting us to participate. So I want to invite you to participate in this part of our worship, which is giving. And I know giving happens in multiple fronts, but one of the places that we invite people to contribute in giving is your finances. You can give at themeetinghouse.com/give. And friends, giving is not just giving of your finances, but it is an act of worship, part of all that we are, giving back to God. And with that, as we transition into musical worship, I want to invite you, honestly, like me, I tell you on a Sunday when we get to worship, I want to put on the dancing shoes and get rocking. So after the singing, the musical worship, we'll go into the teaching and I'll come back and see you. And look forward to just having that interaction and hearing much from what you have gleaned today. God bless you.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. You're hidden.
What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name.
darkness, we were waiting without hope and without light. Till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes. To fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word. From a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. One more time. Praise the Father,
praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King.
But very early on Sunday morning, the women went to the tomb, taking the spices they had prepared. They found that the stone had been rolled away from the entrance, so they went in, but didn't find the body of the Lord Jesus. As they stood there puzzled, two men suddenly appeared to them, clothed in dazzling robes. The women were terrified and bowed with their faces to the ground. Then the men asked, "Why are you looking among the dead for someone who is alive? He isn't here. He has risen from the dead. Remember what he told you back in Galilee, that the Son of Man must be betrayed into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and that he would rise again on the third day." Then they remembered that he had said this, so they rushed back from the tomb to tell his 11 disciples and everyone else what had happened. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and several other women who told the apostles what had happened. But the story sounded like nonsense to the men, so they didn't believe it. However, Peter jumped up and ran to the tomb to look. Stooping, he peered in and saw the empty linen wrappings. Then he went home again, wondering what had happened.
When we left on Good Friday, we were witnessing Jesus' body being laid into the tomb. We've come through Holy Saturday and we find ourselves here on Easter Sunday, the glorious day when Jesus, our Savior and Lord, is alive. He is risen. He is risen indeed. And in a similar posture to how we left the space on Good Friday, we want to take a minute to breathe in deeply and start in a place of reflective prayer, a prayer that speaks to the gift of the one who is risen. This is the invitation that was given to the women at the tomb, and it's the invitation that's given to us as we sit in the glory of this Easter day. If you're looking for a blessing, do not linger here. Here is only emptiness, a hollow, a husk, where a blessing used to be. This blessing was not content in its confinement. It could not abide its isolation, the unrelenting silence, the pressing stench of death. So if it is a blessing you seek, open your own mouth. Fill your lungs with the air this new morning brings, and then release it with a cry. Hear how the blessing breaks forth in your own voice. How your own lips form every word you never dreamed to say. See how the blessing circles back again, wanting you to repeat it, but louder. How it draws you, pulls you, sends you to proclaim its only words. He is risen. He is risen. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Let's turn together to look at these verses that we read in Luke chapter 24 to sit for a few minutes in the story of how we arrive at this place of holding this blessing as our own, of holding this blessing in our own voices. We see these women arrive to the tomb, coming with spices, coming to anoint the body, and they find that he is not there. The angels meet them and declare, "He isn't here, he has risen from the dead," in verse 6. And this is the glorious truth that we are celebrating together today, that we are rejoicing in. Jesus is alive. We serve a risen Savior. He is with us. He has conquered death. He has done everything that was needed for us to be redeemed and to walk in the way that God intends for us, his beloved. And so we want to look at who has Jesus been raised to in these moments, the first witnesses to the resurrection. Who's here? We see the women coming. They're bringing the spices. They are attentive to Jesus, even in death, to care for his body, to honor it, to meet him in that place. And they come in a state of grief. They come I'm sure, in a state of uncertainty, in a state of not knowing what has happened, but they come as they are to where Jesus is, offering what they have, offering what they know, offering what is available to them in worship, to honoring him. And we see that as they come in this place of death, that these women enjoy the privilege of being the first ones to experience Jesus in resurrected life. They are the first ones to learn of the resurrection. They are the first ones to hear everything that has happened. And so who are they? We see in verse 10 that some of them are named. In verse 10, it says, it was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, and Mary the mother of James, and several other women who were witness to what has happened. So Mary Magdalene is a woman that Jesus had cured of evil spirits. We see her several times in scripture. Someone who traveled with Jesus, traveled with the apostles. We know through several different accounts that she was one who was learning regularly from Jesus. And we see in John's account of the resurrection that Mary Magdalene is the first one to see Jesus himself, that he meets her in the garden, that he calls her by name, that he commissions her, that he instructs her to share about the resurrection to the disciples, to the people around her. Also there we see is Joanna, the wife of Chezza, who's the manager of Herod's household. Joanna, we know, is a wealthy benefactor of Jesus' ministry and a follower in his way, that she is giving financial support and that she is a disciple, that she is learning alongside Jesus. And we also see Mary, the mother of James. And so interestingly here, Mary is no longer named the mother of Jesus, but she is the mother of James. For the earthly Jesus is no more. He has been raised to glory through this resurrection. But we see the significance of Mary in this moment, as has been the case all along the way in the life and ministry of Jesus. She continues to be a significant figure, a caregiver, a companion, a disciple of Jesus, and she becomes a significant leader in the early church. We also know that as Jesus' mother, she would have suffered his death, the loss of his life, in a unique way. And it is a beautiful grace of God that she is also among the first witnesses to his resurrection. In addition to these three named women, scripture tells us there were several other women there. And so we see how this invitation is wide open, that there are many witnesses to what has happened, and that their role is then to go on and tell many more. Many are welcome. Many have witnessed the joy of what is taking place this day. And so we can only assume that this group of women, these faithful followers and disciples of Jesus, must have been filled with both joy, but also fear in this moment. What does it mean? He's not where they expected him to be, and they're hearing this truth that he is alive. And so this bubbling of hope that would have been happening in them, could it be that all of their longings, that all of their hopes are being fulfilled? And the angels tell them, go and tell the others. Go and tell the others this good news. Share what you've seen. Even when you don't yet have all the answers, even when you don't yet totally know everything that's coming, go and speak to what you have seen. Share what you do know. Speak the truth of our living Savior. And so these women go back to the apostles. They go back, and verse 11 tells us that they're not at first believed. They're not at first believed. When they speak to this truth that they have seen, that they have witnessed, it's not received right away in the way that maybe they would have hoped for, but they carry on, and we see more and more come to an understanding. For both the women and the men, as we look at this account of the resurrection, we see that they had to have this step of remembering the things that Jesus had told them. We see it in verse 6. The angels remind them, remember what he told you back in Galilee. And in verse 8, that as they listened, as they sat, as they gave their attention, that they remembered the things that Jesus had taught. And so we see the women walk through that, return to what they know, return to what they know. And then the apostles do that as well. They've been learning from Jesus. They've been taking it in. And in this moment, it sinks in even deeper to their understanding of what has happened. That this defeat of death, this coming to new life that Jesus has experienced, has brought all the things that Jesus was teaching them and showing them to fruition. And so what do we want to notice here as witnesses to the resurrection now in our own life of this experience of walking with our Lord? What do we want to notice and hold on to alongside these first witnesses to the resurrection? We want to notice and remember that Jesus is alive and that Jesus is Lord. Our God is not one of the past, but of the present, that right now he is here with us. And that our walk in the way of Jesus is possible because of the death and resurrection. That life in the very presence and power of God is possible because of what Jesus has done. All of the weight that we sat in on Good Friday, the loss and the pain and the lessening and the death, all of those things are defeated because of the power of the resurrection of Christ Jesus. All of the waiting, all of the uncertainty, this liminal space that we've come through in Holy Saturday, where we still don't know what's going to happen, where we don't know if hope is going to hold in the shadow of death, it's thrown aside in this full knowledge, this full certainty, this full victory that Jesus is alive and Jesus is Lord. All of the hope, all of our longing, everything that is needed to accomplish what God hoped for his people is done with Jesus' death and resurrection. This is everything to us. This is everything that is needed. He has risen so that we may know the love of God, so that we may live in the truth of the power and presence of the Holy Spirit with us. And so that even in the spaces in this life that still feel like death, that still feel like uncertainty, that still feel like unbearable waiting, that we can know with certainty that life wins, that love wins, that Jesus is the victorious King who reigns forever. Hallelujah. Amen. Jesus is alive. Jesus is Lord. He is risen indeed.
That same day, two of Jesus' followers were walking to the village of Emmaus, 7 miles from Jerusalem. As they walked along, they were talking about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things, Jesus himself suddenly came and began walking with them. But God kept them from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing so intently as you walk along?" They stopped short, sadness written across their faces. Then one of them, Cleopas, replied, "You must be the only person in Jerusalem who hasn't heard about all the things that have happened there in the last few days." "What things?" Jesus asked. "The things that happened to Jesus, the man from Nazareth," they said. "He was a prophet who did powerful miracles, and he was a mighty teacher in the eyes of God and all the people. But our leading priests and other religious leaders handed him over to be condemned to death, and they crucified him. We had hoped he was the Messiah who had come to rescue Israel. This all happened 3 days ago." Then some women from our group of his followers were at his tomb early this morning, and they came back with an amazing report. They said his body was missing, and they had seen angels who told them Jesus is alive. Some of our men ran out to see, and sure enough, his body was gone, just as the woman had said. Then Jesus said to them, "You foolish people! You find it so hard to believe all that the prophets wrote in the scriptures. Wasn't it clearly predicted that the Messiah would have to suffer all these things before entering his glory?" Then Jesus took them through the writings of Moses and all of the prophets, explaining from all the scriptures the things concerning himself. By this time, they were nearing Emmaus and the end of their journey. Jesus acted as if he were going on, but they begged him, "Stay the night with us since it is getting late." So he went home with them. As they sat down to eat, he took the bread and blessed it. Then he broke it and gave it to them. Suddenly their eyes were opened and they recognized him. And at that moment, he disappeared. They said to each other, "Didn't our hearts burn within us as he talked with us on the road and explained the scripture to us?" And within the hour, they were on their way back to Jerusalem.
Oh my goodness, I see myself in this story, and we were always meant to see ourselves in this moment, even thousands of years later, at different parts of the story. Okay, so what's happened here? This is the brilliance of Luke's recording of the resurrection reality of Jesus. Now, to recap, as Laura just said, in Luke's gospel, nobody has actually seen the body of the Christ, the risen Messiah, Lord and Savior. All of that they've seen is the remnant, is the angels who witness, and they say, "He's not here. Go back and start telling everybody, and he will appear. Buckle up. It is about to get real." Now, if we remember back just a few days ago, there were a collection of people that started to dissipate, to move away from Jesus because of what was happening. And Jesus will enter into the journey once again, like he does, with two people in particular who are on the outer ring of his inner circle. Okay, so the Emmaus Road, you may have heard this before. Maybe this is your first time checking out a church. You're here as a visitor. Welcome. It is about to get real, and you should be seen in the story as well. So the women go to the tomb. Jesus is not there. They are witness to the resurrection and the angels who say he's not here. Wait till you see what happens. Meanwhile, there's another two people who have made their way the 7-mile journey away from Jerusalem onto the Emmaus Road to the village of Emmaus, which in ancient history, we don't actually know where it is or what it was, but the point is the journey, not the destination. And so these two people, they make the 2 to 3 hour walk through windy, rocky roads. It would not have been a straight shot. This was a journey ahead of them to the village of Emmaus, away from Jerusalem, hustling to get away from it all, and absolutely terrified of what might continue to happen. They have just witnessed their Savior, their failed Messiah, a prophet, get crucified at the hands of the Romans under the rule of the Jewish council, and everything seems lost. Now, Luke records that there's a name, there's a person here. It's Cleopas or Clopas and Mary. Most likely, scholars agree, Jesus' aunt and uncle. So this is family. The outer ring, the 72, despite being family, they've abandoned the earliest followers who are hiding in the upper room, and they've said, "We got to get out of here. We got to get out of here." And they are on the road. And what is happening? Now, in some of our translations, it says that they are discussing intently, but the Greek translation of the text says that it literally renders they are tossing words at each other. Now, some scholars would say Mary, Jesus' aunt, is there and might have been one of the outsider witnesses to the empty tomb and is arguing with her husband Cleopas, saying, "This is legit, something has happened," and they're arguing on the road. Now, Jesus catches up with them. Even in their doubt, in the seeming destruction of the story, Jesus catches up. We are meant to see ourselves in this story. I see myself in this story. So they're arguing. They're walking away from Jerusalem, away from the city and the temple of God, the reality of the crucifixion, the death of their prophet. They are walking away back to what is familiar and known. They're wrestling, arguing with the decimation of what they thought would happen, but certainly has not happened in the way that they thought. And you'll notice in the rendering of Luke's description of their discussion, Jesus catches up to them and says something very simple. Literally, "What's up? What are you discussing? What are you discussing so intently?" And their retort is a spicy one. It's a crispy response back to them. Likely Cleopas turns back and, not expecting to see Jesus or anybody else in the middle of the day or maybe early in the morning as they are on their journey, he says, "Are you the only person in all of Jerusalem who has not heard the things that have happened?" Now, it's interesting. Jesus remains hidden to them, not because of necessarily the mysterious supernatural clouding of his physical and resurrected body. It could be, but more likely he remains hidden to them because they have their fear blinders on. I see myself in the story, friends. the fear of external things, the fear of life and sin and pain that clouds us from really and truly seeing God. So Jesus remains hidden, not because he necessarily intended to be hidden, but likely because of this suspicion and fear of the two. I mean, who is this? Who is this that's catching them on the less traveled road to Emmaus, a nowhere village? Who is this that's catching up and wanting to speak with them? Is this a spy? Is this a Roman? Is this like a part of the Jewish council that put their prophet to death? Might we too be tortured and killed? Let's just avoid the conversation. Let's just avoid the questions. Let's avoid saying the wrong thing. Keep the peace. Keep it chill. Let's just move back to where we came from. Get home and get everything back to normal. My friends, I see myself in this story. Maybe you do too. So then Jesus, in his brilliance, repeated through the Gospels, he explains the Hebrew Bible. Did you notice that? Jesus does not just give some like pithy sayings of like, oh, do this and you'll live, do this and you'll live. Instead, he explains the Hebrew Bible. Most scholars would agree it's likely Genesis all the way to the Chronicles. So it's multiple books of the Bible on the walk to Emmaus. He is sticking with them on the path, and he explains the scripture to them on the journey towards eventual fellowship. Scripture, teaching on the journey towards communion together. Do we see ourselves in this journey, in this story? He teaches them on the way, literally on the road. They don't get it. So eventually they arrive to the village, to likely their home or where they've made accommodations, arrangements to stay. And Jesus intended to go on. Now in the NLT, it reads as, it almost seems like Jesus is a tricksy little hobbit. Like he's like, oh, he pretended that he was going. The literal translation is he did intend to pass them through or to continue on with his journey. Literally, Jesus intended to keep going, which is a haunting, arresting statement. And it's in there for a reason. Jesus is walking with them. He's walking with them for 2 to 3 hours on a long and windy journey. And he's explaining scripture through the authority and inspiration of the Spirit that they will soon fully understand. He is walking with them and talking with them on the journey. And then he intends to go onward. In Mark's gospel, it says that he intended to return, or eventually he will return to Galilee, Nazareth, where he first started things out. He is willing to be on the path, to explain the story, to include and invite more people to come and follow him. But they interrupt him now. He intended to go onwards. You've heard what I've taught you. It's yours. You can still be part of the journey, but I'm heading onward. And then another thing happens. What do they ask? They ask for him to stay, not just to stay of like, you can have the room upstairs, like you'll share a bunk bed with one of our kids. No, they ask him to stay and eat. They ask him to stay and eat, to break bread, to stop, slow down. It's getting now late in the day. And now they're literally risking their neck, saying, well, it does not seem like he probably would have killed us or turned us in by now. So Eastern hospitality and just the care for others, love God and love each other. We need to love this brother who is headed somewhere else. Please stay and eat with us, for it's getting late in the day. Now, this is the brilliance of Luke's gospel recording and writing, and the brilliance of Jesus signaling something eternal, a new creation that is now bubbling up in their midst. Luke is clearly echoing something in the eating of eternal significance, the story in their history that has been told over and over and over again. Do we remember how Jesus started this dialogue with explaining the Hebrew Bible to them, Genesis 1? Remember the first meal of the Bible. The moment here with Jesus and these two is heavy, deep, weighty with significance. In the beginning, the woman and the man took some fruit and they ate of it in the garden. She gave it to her husband and he ate of it as well. And their eyes were opened and they knew something had happened. Something had been undone, interrupted, corrupted. Sin entered and separation kept them from knowledge of and intimacy with the divine. This had been the story that had been told over and over and over for thousands of years in their own tradition. And this is the beginning of sin and separation, of the death eventually of humanity. Death itself traced back to this story in the beginning of the Hebrew Bible in Genesis and to this moment. The whole of creation now subject over a meal over a fruit, over a piece of sustenance that was meant to bless. Now the whole of creation is subject to decay, pain, and grief. In other words, life just continues to be a grind. I see myself in this story. Maybe you do too. Life just continues to be such a grind. But now Jesus is staying and eating with them, as N.T. Wright, a New Testament scholar, so brilliantly puts. Now Luke, echoing that ancient story, describes this first meal of the new creation. The first meal of the new creation. He took the bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave it to them. And both their eyes were opened, and they recognized him for who he was, the resurrected Messiah, Lord and God. Verse 31, the couple at Emmaus, Mary and Cleopas, discovered that the long curse has now been broken. Death itself is done with. It's been defeated. God's new creation, brimming with life and joy and new possibility, has now burst in upon the world, ending decay and sorrow. Do you see yourself in this story? Luke is spelling out that Jesus is inviting them and us into the rest of the journey of faith now. Now, and everything has changed. In Christ, we are made new. There is a new creation, literally heaven crashing into earth with resurrection hope and power. The journey of faith that will take us through, not stop with death and decay of sorrow and grief, but that will take us through anxiety and pain to meet and follow Jesus, who has accomplished the work of God's salvation for us. He is risen. He is risen indeed for you, for me, for us. Jesus has accomplished God's work of salvation from sin and death, and now shares the secret with us. And here it is, the gift of presence, the gift of the presence of Jesus by the Spirit with us, his presence of believing and following, our part of it, following and trusting in this Jesus way, the Jesus life that leads us to restoration and new life here and now in this age and the age that is to come. So what is the invitation? Believe and trust in the goodness and love of God and sacrifice of Jesus. He is risen, my brothers and sisters. He is risen indeed for you, for me, for us. And then the invitation to continue on. Jesus intended to continue on, and he invites us along in the path. He invites us, you, me, us, to fully realize and embody this new way, this new creation, by following, by emulating, by imitating, by reflecting Jesus as we go on the journey with him in our with our entire lives. Because Jesus shows us what it means to be human, and to be a human that is fully loved and now accepted by God in this new creation. So what are we invited to do? What is this journey? It is to believe and trust and follow Jesus, because this is exactly how we were designed. This is human flourishing. My brothers and sisters, can you see yourself here? Can you see yourself along the journey with Jesus? Can you see yourself here now on Resurrection Easter Sunday, in this moment, being invited along on this journey of life and faith and trust and new creation? Because Jesus is inviting you into the journey along the path. He intends that you will come with him. My friends, we are invited, no matter your spot on the journey, no matter where and how we encounter fear, no matter how much we think, oh, we're disqualified, or maybe this is too good to be true, you are invited by Jesus to follow him. You, me, us, you are invited to follow him, to enter this new creation of heaven on earth, of the unstoppable force of good that is happening here and now, which is why we celebrate Resurrection Sunday, which is why Easter Sunday is such a big deal in our tradition. And so this is the invitation for you, for me, for us. He is risen indeed for you, for me, for us. And so, brothers and sisters, with every eye open and no heads bowed, my friends, will we say yes? will we say with a loud and celebratory voice, He is risen. He is risen indeed for me, for you, for us. And will we follow this risen Jesus who leads us into the fullness of life and love, who invites us to come along for the journey, trusting Him to show us the way, the truth, and the life now, and in the age to come. This is the invitation that we hope as a Christian community, whether it's your first time here, whether it's your first time hearing this, or whether it's your 500th time here and 500th time hearing this, you are still invited along for the journey. You are accepted by Jesus. You are loved by God. Your sin is dealt with. Death is no longer the end of the story. He is risen. He is risen indeed for you, for me, for us. I want to pray for you and for us that we would accept this invitation. This might seem like an OG altar call, which is exactly what it is. The heart of an altar call is to come to the altar, the presence, the place of God, and to know that God is there accepting you, that He has been wooing you and inviting you into this journey for the whole time. And so I'm going to invite us to pray together, and I'm going to invite you in this prayer to receive the invitation, to be on the journey, on the path, following Jesus. Let's pray together. Jesus, we thank you for your invitation. We thank you for your sacrifice that did away with sin, that ended the penalty of death, and that crashes heaven into earth with new life and new creation. And thank you that nobody is outside of this invitation. And so for those of us that are hearing this for the first time, this invitation that God is love and His love is for us, may we be willing to stand and to follow, to emulate and imitate you, Jesus, to follow you along the path, the way, the truth, and the life. And for those of us who have been on the journey for a long time, may we be reminded in joy of this invitation that we still are following you, Lord and Savior, risen Messiah, God incarnate, who loves and blesses and journeys with us and does not abandon us. May you meet with us, may you continue to lead us, and may we say and embody in a loud voice that Jesus, you are risen indeed for us. And it's in Jesus' name we pray these things. And together we all said, my brothers and sisters, amen, amen. Happy Resurrection Sunday.
I was buried beneath my shame. And who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing, but all my failures I try to hide. It was my tomb till I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave. At the weight of your glory, I needed shelter. I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now you're
with us and celebrating with us today in these really special moments. Enjoy the rest of your day and be blessed.
Welcome back, friends. I don't know about you, but when I hear that invitation from Jimmy and the early disciples on the road to Emmaus, I want to say to you, we are invited to go back into our Jerusalem. But going back into our Jerusalem to share the good news of what this means to us. And the invitation I am reminding you is, if you're wondering how can I get back, I'm inviting you to find a home church. If you've been here or this is your first time, I invite you to begin this journey of your own road to Emmaus by joining a home church, or you can continue this conversation on our Discord server. But above all, friends, the invitation is there. And we want to invite you. We know we have a couple of questions people have asked. So baptism, that is another invitation. Baptism, and if you have prayer requests, I invite you to send those prayer requests. The email below will tell you where to send the prayer request to. But friends, we don't want you to be on this journey alone. Let us do this journey together and look forward to the testimonies that will come back and testify about the goodness of God and how much we find friendship and community as we respond to this invitation. As you go this week, friends, remember, the essence of the church is the Resurrection Sunday. God bless you. Amen. Thank you.